Welcome. You are welcome indeed. God bless you and good morning. I'm Pastor Swofford. Thank you so much for being a part of our Sunday worship service this morning. Pray that everyone is doing well. I pray that the Spirit of the Lord is moving in your life. All of your needs are being met and that the Lord is truly, truly being glorified. Amen. Again, thank you for taking the time to be a part of the service today. We're going to do what we typically do. I only got a couple of announcements I'll share with you, and then we'll get ready to get off and rolling in the Word of God. And again, we're reminding our graduates, if you are a graduate, you're in the class of 2021, we want to hear from you. So you'll see some information up there on your screen. We want to get your names and a photo of you. So you'll see that. So make sure you do that. We have something for you. We want to acknowledge you. Amen. And then my other announcement is that we are recruiting for the multimedia ministry. So if you are interested in being a professional sound engineer, we want to hear from you. We have updated our equipment. We've got some state-of-the-art equipment that we're looking for people who want to be trained. We've got some professionals who are going to be training you. So if you're interested in being a part of this, please call the office and let them know that you'd like to be a part of it. Give us your name and your number. Amen. Well, that is all of the announcements that I have. I'm going to still be in the same message, What's the Matter with the Church? Going to be over in Revelation chapter number 2, and we're going to be looking at the Church of Thyatira today. So get your Bibles out, get your notepads for all of you note takers, and we're going to get ready to get off and rolling in the Word of God right after this selection by Reverend Glenn Hand, Were It Not For Grace.
Time measured up my days, life carried me hard at this world to see if heaven could be gained, just to end where I began, where human effort is all in I can tell you where I'd be. wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, and I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever running and losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to the friend who took my place and ran the course I could not stop. And when he learned in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, and I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever running and losing the race, were it not for grace. Forever running and losing the race, were it not for grace. Amen
and amen again. Thank you, Reverend Hand. To God be the glory, were it not for grace. Can you imagine where we would be were it not for the grace of God? Oh, to God be the glory. We thank God for the grace of God. Amen. Well, let's get ready to get into the Word of God. Open your Bibles with me to Revelation chapter number 2. And I'm going to pray, and we're going to see what thus says the Lord. Bow with me, please. Our Father and our God, the hour has come that your word should go forth in power and in might. And Father, I am the first one to recognize just who the teacher really is, and that is your precious Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, teach us. Open up our hearts and our minds that we might receive the engrafted word of God, which is able to save us, which is able to change us, which is able to bring us out of darkness and into your marvelous light. For this, Lord, we say thank you. Father, we thank you for the authority that you've given us in your word. We exercise that authority right now by binding every devil, every demon, every foul, every hindering spirit. We declare this place Bethel, the house of God. And we also declare it Bethlehem, the house of bread. So we thank you that there is bread in your house today that your children might eat in the name of Jesus Christ. Speak now to our hearts, O God. We listen in Jesus' name. Amen and amen again. Well, you're in Revelation chapter number 2, and our message is titled, What's the Matter with the Church? What's the matter with the church? And my objective in this teaching is to bring the church in line with the will of God. The will of God, the word of God. We're looking at correcting the church, and we are the church. The church is a body. It is a body of believers who have been systematically assembled together by the orchestration of the Holy Spirit. That's us. And when we correct ourselves, when we bring ourselves in line with the will of God, then we're bringing the church in line with the will of God. We've been looking at the seven churches in Asia Minor. These are the seven churches that John the Revelator wrote about when he was banished to the island of Patmos. When he was there, he got a revelation of Jesus Christ. And in this revelation of Jesus Christ, he got a vision, he got a revelation of these seven churches. And when we look at these seven churches, when we study these seven churches, they are representative of all of the Christian churches that exist today. Every one of them, all of them. And every issue, every problem, every challenge, every difficulty that is in the church today, you can find it in one of these churches. And when we find it, we can look at it and we'll know how to bring the necessary correction to the church. So we need to study these churches. And so far, we've looked at three of them. We looked at the church in Ephesus, who was the loveless church. And now I want you to note that I keep giving you some dates, some time frames. In the time frame of the church in Ephesus, was from 32 AD to 100 AD. And those things are kind of important because these churches, they give us stages, if you will, a progression of the church in these various stages. So the second one that we looked at was the church in Smyrna, and the time period there was 100 AD to 312 AD. And then on last Sunday, we looked at the church of Pergamos. And that was the compromising church. And the time frame there was 312 AD to 6000 AD. Now remember, those things, they might seem insignificant now, but those dates are important. It's stages in the church. It shows you the various things that the churches have gone through in the various stages. Now, we've looked at three. We looked at Ephesus. We've looked at Smyrna. We've looked at Pergamos. Now, we've got four more to go. And it's interesting to note, the four churches that are left are churches that really exist this day. I mean, the things that are going on in those churches, the challenge in those churches, it is present to this very day, and these churches will be here when Jesus returns, as we will see in the scripture. So today, we're going to look at the church of Thyatira. Now, let me give you the date. The dates for this church is 600 AD to 1500 AD. 600 AD to 1500 AD. So Thyatira. Now, the meaning, let's look at what does Thyatira mean? It means continual sacrifice. Continual sacrifice. And when you think of the word continual, It means something that goes on and on and on. It's something that does not stop. It is continual, a continual sacrifice. So something was going on in Thyatira. Thyatira would be known as continual sacrifice. So let's look into the Word of God. Let's dig into it. And it's interesting to note about this church. This church is known as the corrupt church. Think about that. Now we're looking at the corrupt church, a corrupt church in Thyatira. And just as there was a corrupt church in Thyatira, think of all of the corrupt churches that exist to this day. This was a corrupt church. And one of the things about Thyatira is that when you look at what Jesus had to say about all of the other churches, he had more to say about this church. He had more to say about this church in Thyatira than any other church. It was a corrupt church, and it needed a lot. It needed things to be said about it. So a lot was said about the church in Thyatira. Now, when you look at Thyatira itself, the city really wasn't that significant. It was kind of a commerce city, a city of, there was some trade and this sort of thing that was going on in the city, but the city itself was not really that significant. You really don't see a lot about it or hear a lot about it in Scripture, but there's some things that we need to dig into in this church. So I'm going to do this one a little bit different. In the last churches, I think I just read everything about that particular church, and then we went to dig into the Scriptures. But this way, we're going to just dig into it, verse at a time. Amen? So let's go to verse number 18 as we look at the church of Thyatira. And to the angel, or the messenger, the pastor of the church in Thyatira, write, these things says the Son of God. This is the Son of God addressing this issue here, who has eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like fine brass. Remember we said that each church gives you a revelation, gives you a picture, a piece of the picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is what you see here. No, remember, no one church has it all. No one church has a complete revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then note something else here. It says, whose eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like fine brass. Note the words fire. Note the word brass. Those words, the words fire and brass, speak of judgment. And that's really quite appropriate by this being a corrupt church. Now, look at verse 19. I know your works. And again, the Lord, this is going to be the positive affirmation here. And the Lord is saying some positive things about this church. He is saying, I know your works, love, service, faith, and your patience. And as for your works, the last are more than the first. So in this positive affirmation, the Lord is saying to the church in Thyatira, I know you. I know what's going on there. I know your works. I know your love. I know your service. I know your patience. And then he goes on to say, in your last works are more than the first. So in other words, what was happening in this church, their works was getting better. It was improving. You know, the work that they started out with, it just expanded. It was more of it. This was a church, when you just looked at it on the surface, you would say, wow, they're really doing it. Their work, their love, their patience, their service, and they are increasing. They are doing better. But listen, don't get confused. Don't think that just because there's some good work going on in the church, that there's not some room for improvement. Don't think that because I'm doing some good things. See, a lot of times, the good that goes on in church causes us not to look at the evil that's going on in the church. We'll look at the good and we'll kind of close our eyes to the very evil that's going on in the church. So the Lord acknowledges the good. He lets them know, I know who you are. I know where you are. I know the work that you are doing. You're doing some good work. However, look at this. Look at the next verse, verse 20. Nevertheless, in other words, in spite of your good works, nevertheless, I have a few things against you. Because you allow that woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. Well, here we go. Here is the nevertheless. So he says to this church, he says to the pastor of this church, the members of this church, I got a few things against you. You have allowed this woman, Jezebel, you have allowed her to teach. You have allowed her to seduce my servants, to commit sexual immorality, and to eat things sacrificed to idols. We need to dig into this. Now, you all know that I did not write the Bible. My name is not in there anywhere. I wasn't even given a biblical name. You won't find Curtis anywhere in here. I am just reading the scripture saying what thus says the Lord. So to this particular church, to the church at Thyatira, he is saying, this is what I have against you. You have allowed this woman, Jezebel, you have allowed her to teach. You have allowed her to seduce my servants. You have allowed them to what? Commit sexual immorality and to eat things sacrificed to idols. Now, let's talk about this church a little bit. Do you remember when the Apostle Paul received his Macedonian call? There was a time when the Apostle Paul had a vision of a man from Macedonia saying, come over and help us. And so the Apostle Paul, he said, this is from the Lord, and I'm going to go. I am going to go, excuse me, to Macedonia, and I'm going to help. And Paul went. And when Paul got there, you know, one of the things that Paul wanted to do, he wanted to find out, well, where is the meeting? Where is the church? Where do the people meet? And he was having a hard time trying to find where the church was. And the Bible says that he went down by the riverside. And he went down by the riverside, and he did not find a man from Macedonia. He found a woman. He found women. And there were women down by this riverside, and they were worshiping the Lord. They were having a church service by the riverside. And it was there where Paul met a woman by the name of Lydia. You all remember Lydia. She was the seller of purple. You remember that? Purple, this purple dye. Purple was a very important color in that day, and they would use it in a lot of clothing, a lot of royal clothing. And this is how Lydia made her living. And Lydia was from Thyatira. And it is believed that Lydia was the founder of this church. It is believed that this church, the church in Thyatira, the church that's being spoken of here, it's believed that it was founded by Lydia. Now, Lydia is believed to have found the church, but there was another woman in the church. As time went on, there was a woman who surfaced in the church, and the Bible identifies this woman, says, and you allowed that woman Jezebel. And there was a woman in this church, a woman of prominence, a woman of influence, a woman of means who was in this church and who caused this church to move in a manner that did not glorify God. Now, I want you to know something here. It says, you allowed that woman Jezebel. Now, listen, in that church, the woman's name was not Jezebel. Jezebel was not her name. The name Jezebel was associated with her because of the spirit that moved her. She was moved by this Jezebel spirit, if you will, and we're looking at the Jezebel of the Old Testament. The Old Testament Jezebel, the spirit that moved this Old Testament Jezebel is the same spirit that was in this woman at the church of Thyatira. That's where the problem was. Now, as we look at this, now remember, let me read this again. You allowed that woman Jezebel, who calls herself, she called herself, wasn't called by God, but she called herself a prophetess. She's teaching and she is seducing people. She led them into sexual immorality and to eat things sacrificed to idols. Sexual immorality, fornication. Now listen, a fornication in the scripture is not always physical fornication. A lot of times in scripture, fornication refers to spiritual fornication. Because think about all of the times that the Spirit of the Lord says, my people Israel have committed fornication. And he was talking about spiritual fornication. He was talking about them moving away from the things of God and attaching themselves to idols, attaching themselves to things that did not glorify him. So the fornication that we're talking about here is going to be spiritual fornication, and then eating things sacrificed to idols that will equate to pagan practices. So this woman, whoever this woman was in the church of Thyatira, this woman who was moved, this woman who was motivated by the same spirit that was in Jezebel, she calls the people in the church of Thyatira to commit spiritual fornication, and she led them into pagan practices that we need to take a look at. Now, also, keep this in mind. When we talk about Jezebel, this woman Jezebel, and the reason that her actual name is not identified and more so giving you the name Jezebel, which lets us know that we're speaking of a Jezebel spirit, a Jezebel of the Old Testament, is because this Jezebel speaks of a religious system. Now, keep that in mind, a religious system. This woman brought in a religious system into the church of Thyatira, a system that was based on the Babylonian mystery religion. Remember that? We talked about that on last Sunday, that how that was a something prominent at that time. And it still had a lot of influence. It had a lot of influence in the church of Pergamos, and it had a lot of influence right here, that Babylonian mystery religion. This woman who was in this church, the church of Thyatira, she began to teach things that came out of that system. She began to lead the people into things that came out of that pagan system. Let's talk about Jezebel. Let's talk about Jezebel of the Old Testament. You remember her. Jezebel was married to Ahab. You remember King Ahab. Jezebel's father was a man by the name of Ethbaal, and he was the king of the Zidonians, I believe. And they were all into Baal worship. Her father, Jezebel's father, was a high priest in Baal worship, in the worship of Ashtaroth, the goddess of fertility. He was high, he was big in these false religions, and he arranged a marriage of his daughter, Jezebel, to Ahab. Ahab was God's, he's a king of the northern tribe, if you will. Now here, Ahab and Jezebel, they've connected. They've united. And a lot of times people would do that in that day. They would do that. They would unite to ally themselves together so that they would appear stronger. They would have more property. And they would just be a more viable force in that day. And so here is Ahab married to Jezebel, the Jezebel of the Old Testament. And you recall the story. We've studied it. Jezebel came home one day and saw Ahab almost in tears, just moping and crying. And she asked him, "What's wrong?" And he said, "There's this man by the name of Naboth. He won't sell me his vineyard." There's a man by the name of Naboth who had some property, had this huge vineyard, and it was near Ahab's property, and Ahab wanted to buy it. Now, the stuff that I'm giving you now, it's important for you to hang on to this because it has a lot to do with this church in Thyatira. So Naboth would not sell Ahab his property. And Jezebel was like, "Hey, you're the king. You should be able to have whatever property you want." She says, like, "Don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. Jezebel gonna take care of it." And so what Jezebel did was she hired some scoundrels who made up a story about Naboth, that Naboth was blaspheming God, which he had not been. And they made up that story and had Naboth killed. And when Naboth was killed, Ahab went and took possession of his property. And because he has possession of his property, now he has more land. Now he's stronger. Now he's more powerful. Now he's more prominent. That same type of thing went on in the church in Thyatira. In other words, Ahab got Naboth's property by inquisition. By inquisition. In other words, it was something almost criminal, something that was made up, a court like a false court, a kangaroo court sort of thing that was made up to make Naboth look like he had done something wrong. He was killed. They wanted to make it look like the killing was justified. And Ahab took his land. Now, that same sort of thing was going on in the church of Thyatira. This woman in this church of Thyatira was kind of leading these people in the same sort of way. Remember this Babylonian mystery religion. In the churches, some of the churches of that day, they began to accept and embrace the practices, the rituals of this Babylonian mystery religion. And one of the churches that embrace this, one of the churches that begin to copy its rituals and its dress was the Catholic Church. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the medieval Catholic Church. Now, I'm not here today, I'm not bashing Catholics, I'm not bashing the Catholic Church, but I need to show you some things, tell you some things, some truths in the Word of God, because this is when the Catholic Church began to come on the scene. It was during this time period. We need to look at that. Now, remember how Ahab got Naboth's vineyard through inquisition. Through inquisition, and he became wealthy. He became more powerful, if you will. When you look at the Catholic Church, the Catholic Church is the most wealthiest church on the face of the earth. And that is not something that just happened. That goes way back. And again, I am looking at, and this is history. This is church history. I'm looking at the Catholic Church in medieval days. And don't worry about, next week we'll look at the Protestant Church, the dead church. But right now we're looking at the Catholic Church, the medieval Catholic Church. Something was going on there. And the reason that they got so wealthy and so powerful, even to this day, when you look at the wealth and the power of the Catholic Church, their banking system and all of the art and all of the property and things that they have, it is mind-boggling. And when you study that, that is what was being spoken of in this church of Thyatira about a sexual immorality or fornication, spiritual fornication. This church was getting so much land. They were gathering so much wealth and power. And in that day, in that time frame that I gave you, what was that time frame again? Around 600 AD till about 1500 AD. Do you know that over 50 million people died during the Catholic Inquisition? Over 50 million people. And so many of those people who died, their land, their property was seized by the Catholic Church. They're accumulating this wealth. There were a lot of things that they were doing, and these were the things that this woman Jezebel was teaching in the church of Thyatira. Another one of the things that they were doing in the Catholic Church is that they would sell indulgence. Indulgence. You might say, what do you mean, sell indulgence? You can go and buy an indulgence. In other words, say, for example, you wanted to go out Saturday night and you were going to party and you knew that you were going to be sinning. You could go in advance to the priest and purchase an indulgence. It's almost a get out of jail free. I can go and sin, and I already have my forgiveness that I've purchased from the priest. So I can go out and sin because I've already purchased my indulgence. People were buying those, and the church was making money off of those. Something else was introduced at that time, something called purgatory. You remember the doctrine of purgatory. And I'm talking about things that were going on in the medieval Catholic Church. I didn't examine to see whether these things are going on today, but these things were taking place in the medieval Catholic Church. There came something called purgatory. In other words, if your aunt died, and she was a member of that church, if your aunt died, they believed that she would go to purgatory. And purgatory was not heaven. Purgatory was not hell. Purgatory was a place of purification, a place where those who had died would go through a purification process so that they would be ready to enter into heaven. And it would depend on how long that you needed to stay in purgatory to be prepared to go to heaven. And say your poor auntie died and you're just missing and you're just worried about your auntie and you just don't want her to just spend all of this time in purgatory. You would go to the priest. You would go to the priest in that day, and poor auntie has died, and I just don't want to see her in purgatory. And the priest says, well, the answer to that is that you must pray and pray and pray and nonstop prayer. You just have to keep on praying. And then you would say, you know, I have a life. I have responsibility. I have children, and I just can't pray nonstop. The priest would say, then you need to light a candle. And you take this candle and you let it burn. And as the candle is burning, that is sending up prayers on behalf of your aunt to shorten her time in purgatory. And you say, oh, great, that's a good idea. And he said, we have them for sale. That's what was going on in the church. It was at that time where confessions were brought into being. It was at that time, in that day, the Bible in that church was literally chained to the pulpit. In other words, it wouldn't leave. And then it was written in a language, in Latin usually, that no one could understand. So people were kind of helpless in that day. People didn't have access to the Word of God. They had to depend on someone else. They had to depend on a go-between. They had to depend up on a priest. They had to depend upon someone going to the Father on their behalf because they were taught that, well, I can't go to God. I need someone to go for me. And it was in that time where Mary was known as the Queen of Heaven. And people thought that she had some kind of special access to the Father, which she does not. She does not. You know, the last recorded words that Mary said is when they were at that wedding and Jesus turned the water into wine. Mary's last recorded words were, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Whatever he says, do it. Jesus is the way. He is the only way. There is no one that we need to go through, but that is the spiritual fornication that was being taught in Thyatira. That's what was going on there. So remember, it was two things. It was that sexual immorality, which is what fornication, which we know is what spiritual fornication. And then the other one was what? Eating things, sacrifice to idols. Eating things. It had to do with eating. There was another thing that was going on in that church, and it was happening around the communion table. Have you ever heard the word, let me try to say this, transubstantiation, transubstantiation. And basically what that means, it's speaking of communion, you know, the Eucharist, that when they were taking communion, that word means that they believed that the communion, that the bread and the wine would actually miraculously turn into the actual body, the physical body of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is what that meant. It meant that when they were taking communion, they believed that that body was the actual body and the wine was the actual blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we have communion, notice what we say. This is symbolic. This is representative of the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, but not with them. They believed that it was the actual body and that it was the actual blood that somehow miraculously it would turn into the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, just imagine that. That means that every time they approach the communion table, it would be like the sacrifice of Jesus, his sacrifice, his death on the cross, going on again. Every time they would approach the table, he would be sacrificed again. But the Bible says what? When Jesus died on the cross, that sacrifice was once and for all. He only died on the cross once. He was sacrificed once. Even in the Old Testament, when you see these Old Testament sacrifices, you know, that was even then for a limited time. That was only for a period of time that Jesus could come on the scene and be the ultimate sacrifice. That had an end to it. But in this church, because of their belief of this transubstantiation, believing that it was the actual body of Jesus, that he was being sacrificed over and over and over again. And remember the name of the church? Thyatira means what? Continual sacrifice. This continual sacrifice, and it was to the point where it made communion itself, it made it a sacrifice. It made it sacrifice to an idol. It made the ritual itself an idol. And that is what was going on in that church. That happened there. It was going on in that church. Spiritual fornication, eating food, sacrifice to idols. That's what was being taught to the people. The people were being seduced into this thing, thinking this was the way. This is how I maintain my salvation. This is how I gain access to the grace of God. And I have to depend upon this priest. I have to depend upon this person because I can't go to the Lord for myself on my own. And that is just not the case. Let me read on a little bit. Go with me to verse number 21. And I gave her, talking about this woman, and I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. So he said, hey, listen, I gave her time. And that's the good thing about the Lord. That's the love of God. He gives all of us time. He gives us time to repent. But that time is not indefinite. It just doesn't just keep right on going. He'll give us time to repent. And look at verse 22. Indeed, I will cast her into a sick bed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds. So he says, I gave her time to repent, and then I'm going to cast her in a sick bed. And those who commit adultery with her, all of those who are involved in it. And then notice that it says, into great tribulation. Now, this is not the tribulation that will occur, but great tribulation there means great trouble. In other words, this church is going to have great trouble. And have you, what church even now that you see experience great trouble? What church do you see now that's involved in sexual immorality? We see that even now. And where am I? Look at this, verse number 23. I will kill her children with death. Wow, that's pretty sad. I will kill her children. Now, that's not talking about their little kids, their babies that they may have. He's talking about this church and the offspring of the church. You know, churches oftentimes spring off of other churches. And just as this church in Thyatira, this Catholic church, if you will, her offsprings, in other words, churches that grew out of that church, like the Methodist church. You see, these would be the offspring. You would find some of the same things. I've been in the Methodist church. I've seen a lot of the things in the Methodist church that you saw there in the Catholic church. This is the offspring. And let's see, I will kill their children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the mind and heart. He searches the heart. He searches the mind. And I will give to each one of you according to your works. I'm going to get according to my works. Let me read on. Look at verse 24. Now to you I say, and to the rest of Thyatira, as many as do not have this doctrine. Now, it wasn't everybody. There were those in the church of Thyatira who didn't get sucked into that doctrine. You note this, who have not known the depths of Satan. As they say, I will put on you no other burden. See, there were those in the church of Thyatira who did not have that doctrine. They didn't accept it. They didn't believe it. Who have not known the depths of Satan. The depths of Satan. Now, the depths of Satan is something that came out of Babylonian mystery religion. Remember when we were talking about that on last Sunday? We were talking about the hat. I don't know what it's called, the hat that the Pope wears. That hat, that symbol, came out of Babylonian mystery religion. And when it came out, there was something on the hat. And even to this day, when you look at that hat that the Pope wears, there are two keys on that hat. And what those two keys mean is that I have the understanding of the deep things, the deepness, the depth. Now, this day, I'm sure what they will say is, well, those are the keys of the kingdom that Jesus and Peter was talking about. Could very well be. But when it came out of this Babylonian mystery religion, it represented deep, mysterious knowledge that only I have. I have the keys. I have ultimate understanding. And if you need to know something, you need to come to me and through me. God is too awesome. He is too holy for you to approach him on your own. You don't have this. You don't have the education that I have. You don't have my theological background. That is not necessary when it comes to knowing God. Yeah, that's all good. You know, it helps. A lot of times, listen, understand this. You don't need to be a theologian to understand the Bible, to understand the Word of God. A lot of times we think we need so much, and some things help. Sometimes we think, well, I need the Greek and I need the Hebrew. Those things, they help, but you don't need it. I heard a preacher say this when he was talking about Greek and Hebrew. He said, Greek and Hebrew is like underwear. It gives you support, but it don't need to be seen. Amen. It'll help you. Yeah, it'll help you to understand the Bible, but it won't draw you closer to the Lord. A relationship with the Lord, being drawn closer to the Lord, comes out of a desire in your heart, a desire to know him, a desire to want to be close to him. You can ask the Lord, Lord, give me understanding of your word. Lead me and guide me into the truth of your word. And he will do that. And you see, all of this was going on in the church of Thyatira. Let me read on. Verse 25. But hold fast what you have till I come. So he's telling the folks, hold fast. Notice he's not pulling anybody out of there. He's not delivering anybody out of there. And the Lord will do that with us. He won't always take us out of a bad situation. He'll tell us, hold fast. Hang on in there. What? Till I come. And he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nations. He shall rule them with a rod of iron. He's not talking about beating somebody over the head, but it speaks of the authority that we have. They shall be dashed to pieces like a potter's vessel. I also have received from my Father, and I will give him the morning star. The morning star is the Lord Jesus. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. Amen. That's the church in Thyatira. Bow with me, please. Father, we thank you for this time in your word. We pray, O Lord, that your word has been seed sown on good ground, and that it will produce fruit in the name of Jesus Christ. And then there may be those of you under the sound of my voice, and you've never asked Jesus to be your personal Lord and Savior. The Bible says that he who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So whoever you are, wherever you are, call upon the name of Jesus. He'll save you. Just say, Jesus, come into my heart. Jesus, I confess you as my personal Lord and Savior. If you say that, if you believe that in your heart, then you are a child of God. And I welcome you to the body of Christ. Amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you so much for being a part of our worship service this morning. I pray that you all would have a safe, a blessed rest of the day. And I'll see you all tomorrow on Pastor's Corner. Take care, everybody.
Thank you for joining today's broadcast. Please visit us on our website at rolcm.org.